Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for your patience and for joining us. My name is Ariana Rabago, and I'm with the City of Ventura. I'm super excited to host this event as part of our first ever sustainability speaker series. The series aims to provide education to residents from local experts on a wide variety of sustainability topics. And this event is titled Stewardship, a Chumash Perspective. It's brought to you by Julie Tumamait-Stenslie. And for those who don't know, the Chumash are indigenous peoples and were some of the original inhabitants and still do inhabit the coastal areas of Central and Southern California, including Ventura. It is a special honor to have Julie with us to share insight on Chumash stewardship. Julie gets her Chumash heritage from her father's side, and they are island descendants, tracing their lineage to Santa Cruz and Santa Rosa Islands. Julie lives in the Ojai Valley with her husband and their three children. She is an educator, consultant, storyteller, and a fierce advocate for the land and all its beings. Her work puts her in many places where she engages with people of all ages. Before I introduce Julie or pass the mic to Julie, I just want to say again, we'll try to answer your questions as they pop up in the chat and then also give you some time throughout to answer if you want to go live. Thank you so much for being here. Julie, thank you so much for being here.
Well, thank you. Thank you for this invite. And I'm very grateful to be able to do this and to have so many people attending. It to me is so important to that if you want to know about indigenous peoples or anywhere, people around the world, we are all indigenous at one time. But to know the land and just how abundant, you know, some places are, and you look at weather and all that, you have an opportunity to get to know the people. Before I start, I really, you know, want to emphasize that as we go through this series, later on, I'll be doing one in April, but our medicines, our native plants and medicines, all plants have some medicinal properties. I want to, as a disclaimer and just to caution you that to really, if you're investing in native plants and want to start using them, please be very careful. Have a professional come, you know, don't go out foraging. Don't go picking berries and things like that without absolutely knowing that that's what they are, that they're safe. There's a lot of lookalikes out there that can make you very ill. But the other issue is that if you are using plants for medicinal purposes, and you must talk to your doctor about them. Because our medicines are powerful. They're really potent. What keeps your body well is the continuous use of herbal medicinal plants. Sometimes your prescription drugs that you're taking can have a horrible, sometimes devastating effect and counteract one another. So if you're on any prescription medications and you want to start using herbals, just please go to your doctor and let them know. Sometimes it can be perfectly fine, but just let them know to make sure that you're not taking something that's going to make you severely ill and counteract what you're already taking. So I just wanted to say that. Because there has been some devastating effects on people, and then you can research that also. So with that, I want to thank you again for joining me, and just to, you know, bring in just a quick just acknowledgement of where we are in this time, as we're hoping that we get rain in this winter time. We got a tiny bit. We get some snow in our mountains here. I'm in the Ojai Valley. And I'm anxious. I want the rain. But as we're getting into and out of this winter time, to always has been a time to stay indoors and be safe and quiet and let the lands rest. But you know, we've been doing that and being indoors for a long, long time. So but still, you know, we do acknowledge this change in seasons as we're going to be coming up into spring. And we just acknowledge our surroundings in our place. So with that, and our relatives, those living and those past, we want to acknowledge our sense of place here and the people that came before us and those that were brave enough to talk about different knowledge on the Chumash culture, about their life stories, their practices, all that. Few people in those days went around talking to these relatives of ours. So we're thankful for that. So I want to start off with, and I'm going to read because I've already gotten off my script. So that I don't know how far I'll get through this. I have pages here. But I want to start out with saying, language is a flower. This was spoken by Placido. He was a native person living at the San Buenaventura Mission. And he was baptized at the age of 21. But in the reports and the histories, Dr. Cephas Bard, who was there in Ventura, his practice, he traded a lot, and most of all of his collection ended up in the Historical Society and can be seen at the Ventura County Museum. But he recorded Placido as living to 136 years old. So that's pretty amazing. So I wanted to also define, or in the dictionary, sustainability, avoidance of the depletion of natural resources in order to maintain an ecological balance. But then there's other ways of how people talked about, being careful with the earth. Leviticus 25:23, God instructed man not to overuse the land and allow it to lie fallow every 7 years. And again, another quote, if you plan for a year, plant rice. If you plant for 10 years, plant trees. If your plan is for 100 years, educate children. And that's Confucius. Today, we are living today only because the generations before us, our ancestors, provided for us by the manner of their responsible living. That was Simon Ortiz, Acoma Pueblo, 1998. White people want our land, want destroy us, break and burn all our baskets, break our pounding rocks, destroy our ropes, no snares, no deer skins, no flint, nothing. Lucy Young Lasik, a Walakai elder, in 1936, she was 90 years old. And then another one, who are you going to speak to? There's nobody left. This was what was said to my father, Vincent Tumamait, by his father, Cecilio, in regards to why should I teach any of you the Chumash language? Now, this was the time my father was born in 1919. And his father, I wish we had more information. He was a naturalist. He loved the plant world and was very excellent at it and helped many of the people, his relatives and other Chumash families throughout the lower Ventura Avenue in Ventura at his time. So, much of that has been lost to us. But we have 1,500 species of plants in the Chumash region, which is approximately, for those of you who don't know our territory, 7,000 square miles, including four channel islands. We have Anpaca, which is Anacapa. We have Limu, Santa Cruz, Wima, Santa Rosa, and Tucan, which is San Miguel. And we go as far south as the Topanga Canyon. And we go north all the way up to, on the western end of San Luis Obispo County, out into the back countries of Cuyama and San Joaquin Valleys. So we have a very large territory that from mountains to ocean. So, we explored and moved all about these places. To mention all these plants and their uses would take a very, very long time. Let me just say that all plants and trees have multiple uses that include food, medicine, clothing, shelter, storage, utensils, tools, ornamentation, games, weapons, and religious paraphernalia. Plants are a part of the philosophy in prayer and offerings. They are woven into and are an essential part of the sacred world in our songs and stories. Certain ones help a person obtain a spirit helper or dream helper, or what we call an atishwin. I want you to, once you get to think about the history of California, and you think about the roads we travel, and you think about them at a time when they were just dirt roads with the horse and buggies, going from place to place and town to town, visiting work, families, even holidays. When you take a drive or go on holiday, imagine in the days of the horse and buggy. Think how long that took. Imagine moving about on foot. That's how it was. The horse came in with the Spanish. The Chumash lived in permanent villages. They also had seasonal camps in which they moved about and on foot, again, visiting. You know, I don't think bear wanted to take them anywhere, and deer said, no way, go on, go walk. So, you know, they moved about. And so when you come, they also went in their journeys to collect food at certain areas where only those foods were abundant. They would go to celebrations where some of those were up on large high mountains. We're all surrounded here in Ojai by mountains. We have our sacred mountains. I tell people, if you want to know where our sacred mountains are, look where the cell towers are, because they're the highest peaks, and we didn't want interruption either. So these people would spend who knows how long journeying to these sacred places. And the journey, the sacredness, when people want us to define, you know, well, how is that mountain sacred? Where does it start? Well, it starts when the people leave their home. And that journey is, it takes some days. They stop, they rest, they maybe pick up other people as they're, you know, moving out and going on this pilgrimage up to the sacred mountaintops. So the whole journey was sacred. And, you know, we know some of our sacred mountains, but they would stop and rest. And what we see now, how we travel today, we are traveling on those same old pathways. They've become our roads and our highways. And once you get familiar with these plants and trees and our natural environment, you'll start noticing something about your surroundings and on these roads. You'll see that these roads and highways are lined with trees for shade and food. There were shrubs and bushes, some having food, other like berries, and berries were always a welcome source, or even medicine. They meander around or near water. You get an idea of how they sustain themselves while on the road. And if you take another look, you'll see all the non-native species that have overgrown, just invasive plants, trees that are choking out the native trees, the native grasses, and the riverbeds. You know, they, especially one of our main culprits is the Arundo Donax, and where our native grasses, people are really trying to restore those places, to replace, to get rid of that Arundo, which was so invasive. It just chokes out everything. So with our reeds and our grasses, the tule grass, the juncus, and other plants that grew in the waters, which filters our water. So we are trying to restore and bring all that back and get rid of that Arundo. We have very little of our native grasses and weeds and willows left. These plants filter our waters. They were also, some of that were basketry material, housing material, brought, if the Spanish had only thought for a moment that, you know, let's go see what's over there first. So where the willows could have been the substitute for that Arundo, that bamboo, that bendable, you know, for ramadas and other things that they built. So, you know, we really have to be careful, you know, and kind of learn the difference in how these plants, I'll get a little bit into that more later. If there's anything right at this moment that anybody wants to ask, I'm just going to stop every now and then. And if there's anything in the chat that anybody has, but if anybody has any questions now, we'll go ahead and take them.
We haven't got anything in the chat yet. Okay. If anybody wants to unmute themselves or ask to be unmuted, please feel free to do so. Okay. I don't see anything coming in, so let's just keep.
Sure. You know, you can gain so much knowledge just looking around if you own property here in Ventura County, or you plan on owning property, to take an inventory. Once you get more familiar with our native plants and our trees, you can see around your neighborhood what native versus non-natives. And you can learn your watershed. Some people don't know which is the nearest watershed that they live to near. Ours here is the Ventura River. I'm in the little community of Miners Oaks, and it's very close to the place where I grew up. I mean, when we grew up, it was called the River Bottom. So I loved being there and growing up there. As I got older and we started learning our ancestry, it turned out we were living and growing up in the same riverbed that our great-great-grandmother, Alulamewe, Maria Ricarda. Alulamewe means one who drags her feet. that was the same river that she grew up in. So knowing that later on, I thought, what a great place to be in your homeland. And you can always guarantee and bet that there's going to be native villages all along the rivers. Water was essential and still is essential today. So, you know, we discover those inadvertently at times or during floods or development along these rivers. There's another invasive plant was part of the culprit that, you know, with our wildfires that we had here, especially here with the Thomas fire. And people come in meaning well and thinking, oh, you know, we better stop this erosion here. We got this great grass that we're going to plant, the ryegrass. Now, our native, again, taking a step back and learning about our native landscapes and how our native grasses and plants, they have deep, deep roots that are really stable and they're locked in. And when fire comes through, that ryegrass, as soon as the waters are done, the rains are done, it dies. It becomes fodder. And it really exacerbated the fires. It was fuel for it. Where the native grasses, they can withstand the time without water because they are drought tolerant. So, you know, it's management ways of looking at how to manage the landscape and forest and all those things. Go to the native plants first before, you know, introducing and bringing food in. Okay, where am I? I'm losing. See, when I go off schedule, there we go. Okay. And although that we were devastated by these fires, it was just amazing to look around at the last, after the Thomas fire and the post regeneration of the plants that are actually fire chasers that only come out, crack out of their seeds as fire comes through. And the nitrogen that was laid on the ground through the ash, we were seeing plants two, three times their sizes and multitudes of it just all over meadows, just full of all of these fire followers. So it does have benefits to our environment. Native peoples have a long history with fire, and it's been unrecognized for a century or more. So as people are starting to learn, other nations up north are working with the Forest Service to introduce and bring back fire. So as a way of clearing. So, you know, they did that just to, you know, some smaller trees like our oaks, for instance, some of the people would just burn those smaller oak trees in order to make room and to keep the larger, older 500, 600, 700-year-old oaks to fruit and have the acorns and to clear brush. It was a good way to, when the grasses got really high, you did your burn. It made for those new sprouts to come up, which fed your animals. And as we hunted those animals, those game animals, it made it easier to see them as they were out in those meadows and fields. You can see people coming at a distance when you did those controlled burns to give clearance. So there was a lot of benefits to those, to having those fires. And we brought native animals, which were, and we're going to talk about fire a little bit. I did a little bit, but I wanted to tell you a little story because I thought, you know, having our culture and weaving in some of our stories about the benefits of fire. In one of our creation stories, the Rainbow Bridge story, the Hutash, Mother Earth, she was out on the islands and she had all kinds of things out there, animals, people, plant, not people yet, but plants. But she got that idea to bring people onto this earth. And as she gifted everybody, the people that she created, it was her husband, the Sky Snake, or today we call him the Milky Way, who couldn't think of anything to give him. Like, hey, look, you gave her everything. You didn't leave me nothing. So anyway, he thought of a really great idea. And with all his power, the Sky Snake shot down a bolt of lightning and hit the ground and fire was created. The people love this gift. And as they moved about, they really, you know, they took it into their homes. They could stay up late at night with the fires burning. But in this little story, poor Condor. Now you've seen Condor. He's here. We almost lost our Condor, but you see how he looks today. Out there on the island, Wit was a beautiful, handsome bird. Beautiful white feathers all over his head and his wings. Beautiful, almost 10-foot wingspan, just body, just gorgeous tail feathers, all white. Well, he saw what was going on and he was curious about that. So he decided to investigate a little bit. And as he saw the smoke whirling off and coming off the flames up high into the sky, he flew far down to get a better look. But then all of a sudden that smoke got in his eyes and they started painting him and he couldn't see where he was going. Pretty soon he felt the heat of the flames and he cried in pain and the fire took him. They took all those beautiful white feathers off his head. That's why his head's all red and wrinkled today. The rest of his beautiful white feathers were all scorched and charred black, except for those white stripes that are underneath his shoulders and on his wings. He flew off the island and vowed never to come back. And you know, to this day, he has not returned. But poor Wit, but he's needed in this world. He is part of the birds that are, that they take care of all the carnage and everything on the highways and roads, and they keep the world clean. We need them and the turkey vultures. So he, poor birdie. That's what gets him for being so curious. Now I wanted to go back to talking a little bit about the value of having native plants in your properties and in your communities. I see a lot of native plant gardens going in schools. We have some here in Ojai. And partly it's because it causes a lot of damage when you go out. I don't like sending people out into the forest because we get a little greedy as people. And we have to remember that the native plants are right exactly where, you know, Mother Nature put them. And by taking them out, you're doing a lot of different things. But to consider, you know, when you own a home, that, you know, you'd be very happy there. You know, you got best of both worlds here in this region, so close to the ocean, up to the mountains there. And you can create a very, you know, sustainable, lovely landscape in your yard. Your water bills, you know, that saves water, having those type of plants. And you add value. You add value to your home, too, especially if there's oak trees on your property. There's one little plant. As people, you know, come in, I love roses, don't get me wrong, but there's one little rose, our wild rose, that is very, very beautiful. It's simply beautiful. It's sweet smelling. It's a delicious edible parts. All parts of plants are useful. So as we, you know, you just can't go wrong with them. They're soft and their colors are beautiful pink little petals with a yellow center in the middle. And the other roses are a little greedy. You always have to feed them, fertilize them, keep them watered. But with the wild rose, it's so adapted to this environment. You really don't have to do much to it, but use it, take advantage of it, and learn how to process So just a few things. The petals were used as powder, like baby powder, when they were dried and scrunched up, and then they had that beautiful fragrance to them. And it was used like on the little baby's bottoms after they had their bath and, you know, they put their, you know, new changing of everything on them. If your eyes are sore and red, you let the petals sit in water and let those oils drain out of there. And you place the water as an eye wash, and it soothes your eyes and gets rid of the redness of your eyes. You can also make a tea out of it too. And it was good for colic with children and stomach pains. The little rose hips where the seed pods are in, those are edible. Remove the seeds out of there and save those. Because when you start learning other people who are invested in native gardens, you can do seed swaps. You can plant them in your yard and just start keeping them going there. The rose hips made real pretty earrings that the women would tie onto their ears or necklaces around their neck. It reminded me of growing up. I'm born really a long time ago. But so, well, I think they still have them now. And some of the stores, little candy necklaces that you can wear, and they got the little stretchy cord. And you can chew on the little candy. Well, that's kind of like how the rose hip necklaces, if you get hungry, they're high in vitamin C. Everything has either a chemical medicine or a value to the body that is very essential. So that you can buy rose hip teas. It takes a long time to get your plants established, but once you do, it's great. In the meantime, your health food stores have rosehip tea. It's very delicious. And then you get that added benefit of the vitamin C. Okay, let's see. Any questions there?
Yeah, Julie, we've got a few. So let me go ahead and read some off to you. Mm-hmm. Okay. Chris Leslie wants to know, are you involved with some of the native plant promoting nonprofits like California Native Plant Society?
I know some people there, David Magny. I've known him for a long time. I'm not involved with them yet. I'm doing a lot of things right now that I'm going to be kind of pulling myself away from that and getting more involved with plants. I've always loved plants growing up, herbs and homeopathic, even with my animals. I'd rather go there first for anything that ails us than going to the doctors and getting penicillin or any of those type of things. But no, not necessarily on a regular basis, but my intent is.
Thank you. And then I've got a couple other questions about how do you feel about pesticides and chemicals to remove invasive species? And what do you think the effective is on other native?
That's a tough one because, we have put so many things into this land without any concern or regards for what's already here. I don't like pesticides, but here's the alternative. Go volunteer. Get yourselves out there into the watersheds and start helping pull that Arundo out. That's, again, I don't like it. It has been used and there are some that are, they're poisons. I don't know how there can be a safe poison, but they say that there are safe poisons. But really, it's the lands have been devastated with so much of that invasive, the kudzu. All that stuff that's growing as my journey to Santa Barbara going over the 150, that plant is everywhere now. And I don't think anybody's doing anything about that. That's a really invasive plant and grows very quickly. So, we must do our part. If we want to sustain our watersheds, we need to get rid of the Arundo. And not only that, we need to talk to private owners who have property in the watershed that will let us in, because you have to get to the top of the watershed to work your way down. You cannot leave an inch of those roots in anywhere because they just multiply. So that's the alternative to pesticides, is to get out there and start pulling it and volunteer with the Ojai Land Conservancy, volunteer. I'm on the board at the Santa Clara River Conservancy, and they do a great job with volunteers and different times at set that people come in and they help remove it. And they've been doing an awesome job with that. That's a good question. Thank you.
Thanks, Julie. And then I'll ask one more question from this round, for this round. Will we lose any of our native chaparral plants due to the frequency of fire?
I don't think so. No, no. We've had thousands of years of fire because of those roots being so deep in the ground. They restore themselves. One of the things that is not good to do is to go throw seeds out there. Just give them time. Give them a little bit of room and don't reseed after fires. Just let them, nature knows what it's doing. It's been doing it for a very long time. So just, you know, let it be and they'll restore them. They'll restore their place within time.
Thank you, Julie. And then we're at 6:45.
Already? Holy cow.
Just want to make sure that you're not going.
Well, we promised at least an hour, or maybe a little more. So we got started late.
Yeah.
So I'm fine. I'm good.
Okay, great.
So you know, when you do that, you get all those benefits of all the little furry creatures, the birds, the butterflies. You know, you'll have that, you'll have that sense of beauty, the sounds, you know, that inspire you. And you know, it is just such a, to get to know that relationship and to build that relationship with where you are living. I want to go to the oak trees, and I could spend a whole series on oaks. I love them. And I've dealt with them for many, many years and processed the acorns. And I love doing that today. You know why? Because I have a blender. I don't have to sit there pounding acorns in a mortar anymore like my relatives. You just get a blender and there you go. But you still have to pick them up off the ground one by one. So it's I love tedious things. I, you know, I take knots out of chains. I mean, that's kind of who I am. But the oak tree can get very, very old. And I've been around a couple really super ancient old oak trees. The one up at Mehrmount up in the Upper Valley, which was probably 600-700 years old. The teaching tree at the Ojai Foundation, beautiful. They're supposed to canopy on the ground. Their branches lay down and people trim them up and get them so they're top heavy. They build around their drip line. Their drip line is at the edge of where the branches come out. And if you build, if put things or non-native plants that you're watering, you can kill them. So you got to give them room. You got to leave them room to spread out and do what they're supposed to do. We've lost a lot recently through those fires, but they do add value to your property. They're a keystone species. There's over 500 species of oaks. And everyone in the community, the oak wood community benefits, and we do too. There was a survey, I kind of looked it up quickly because I wanted to see just what the count was on oak trees around the county. So this is dated way back 2006, but it gives a population of oaks, blue oaks, 134 acres worth, not all in the same place, just, you know, they kind of count up the acres where they find them. So in Ventura County, there's only 134 acres of blue oak. Coastal oak, 47,754 acres of the coastal oak, and 1,050 acres of the valley oaks. Now, with our climate change, with all the pollution that's in our air, I just lost my thought, with everything going out of balance, and our we need to be planting these oak trees, and we need to get them to do the work that trees do, and that's to filter our air. So, you know, the carbon emissions, that's what I was gonna say. So, you know, we have a process in our counties and cities that you can cut down oak trees. And it just breaks my heart when I hear that. I've done blessings for people as they're having to cut down an oak tree because it wasn't cared for properly and it's going to come down. It's rotted inside. And it's really, you know, a sad thing to do, but to honor it and to pray for it as it's, you know, given so much to us. and bunnies. I love bunnies. But, you know, so in 2006, it was stated that in agriculture, Aglansee, when people came over here and they started doing all those things of agriculture and destroying, you know, woodland places for ag or ranching for grazing, things like that, you can fell 5 to 25 trees without a permit in a 12-month cycle. So every year you can fell up to 25 trees in ag without permits. Non-ag, you can do 3 cumulatively, not annually, without a permit. And you know, again, people sometimes find ways to sneak cutting down oaks. And I you know, I really find that really disrespectful. And I don't, you know, I don't know. I guess I shouldn't really say that, but because who knows the reasons why? I don't know. I don't know all the reasons why. It's just so when I hear a chainsaw, I go running around my neighborhood, find out you got a permit for that. oak trees are sacred. They're sacred to many cultures, not just indigenous people. They're all around the world. But for the Chumash, we were taught, and we are taught, that they are the children of the moon. An oak can become someone's atishwin or spirit helper. And because the moon is one that comforts and soothes and realigns and soothes your emotions, so can an oak tree. So it can be a spirit helper. And sometimes, you know, you're walking out somewhere and you might see a little glint right by a tree and it makes you do that double take like that. It might be your tree, it might be speaking to you. It's home for many species of animals. Somebody just mentioned one of them, the bunnies. Birds, rodents, deer, butterflies, millipedes, moths, snakes, salamanders, owls, scrub jays, hawks, eagles, magpies, bluebirds, acorn woodpecker, foxes, wood rat, and bees, in which we need them today. They are, and the other pollinators. Ag depends a lot on pollinators. There are just so many other little, you know, tiny little, you know, animals that live in that community of the oaks. So, you know, we can predict the weather. This was something I discovered in 2005, that you look at the oaks at the beginning as they're flowering. Some people are very, I'm allergic a little bit to that pollen flower, but not the acorns, that you check and you keep watch. I got a few that I watch and keep an eye on every year. And I look at the time of year that they're starting to grow. And then I pay attention to when they drop. I pay attention to the size of them. And all that can tell you what kind of rain we're going to get. And the way I relate to that is that I see the oaks as mothers. And I see them dropping those babies on the ground saying, grow, grow, the rain's coming. There you go. Or no, it's going to be dry. It's going to be cold. I'm going to put you down, but you know, you're going to have to, you may not make it. And they're tiny, they're little. So, you know, paying attention. And that's what, you know, people do. They're observant. They, you know, watch and they look around. So, you know, the people, we had so many uses for the oaks. People were gathering the acorns, cracking them open to make sure you can't leave them in the shell because there's too much water in them and they rot. Crack them open and you build a granary basket, big round one out of willow, line it with sage. And the sage is an insecticide, so it keeps the bugs out of your acorns. And you fill it, you keep it filled. You can, if it's a good harvest, you can eat acorns the whole next year. And you only pull out though the ones that you want to eat for prepare your meals. So stone tools were an essential necessity for this. We built these, made these round bowls out of sandstone with a hole. Well, sometimes they were just shallow and by the pounding with your hand tool created these big divots, or you're out by the water and there's these big boulders with these indentations in them. They call them bedrock mortars. And the women spend their time just pounding this acorn and they would pound and pound. We have a song, but I haven't learned it yet for pounding. There was one that I learned that from the Maidu people. And it just honors the tree. It honors the blossoms. It honors, you know, that process. And it's, you know, you sing it to that rhythm of pounding. The women sat on the rocks and, you know, it's like a quilting club or you sit there and pound your acorns and share stories. Once you got them into the flower, you put them in a basket and then you take that basket or you bring water to the basket, and that leaching, you wanted to remove that tannin out of the acorns. I don't know how many of you, excuse me, have tried to eat an acorn that's very bitter. Get you right back there. Well, you had to take that tannin out of there, tannic acid it was called, but tannin, and you rinsed it and kept rinsing and pouring water into that basket of acorn flour. And then you would taste, you would just taste it from time to time. And you know, it was okay until you could either tolerate that bitterness, or you can just keep going. You don't ever really leach it out completely. And the water, I do it in my sink so I can see the water. It's dark, it's black. But you know, during the times that the tannin was beneficial for you. But once you got it into that flour, you had a basket near your fire. You put hot rocks in your fire, throw them in the basket, swirl it around with your acorn and water, and you would eat your acorn soup after it thickened up. It's like making cream of wheat. But it was to know that the nutritional value of acorns is amazing. So once it was done that way, the acorns were a whole food. The only problem with us today is we're not active enough because it has a lot of carbs, it has a lot of fat content in it. But we ate acorns for every meal, a serving or so, with all of our other dishes. But it has everything your body needs. You can buy leached acorn on the internet. Other states here, I've bought some, gifted some from up north. So it really makes for a gluten-free, there's no leavening in it because it's gluten-free. So you can mix it with flours, but I make bread sometimes. And when I make bread, I make a big pot of beans because if you don't eat your bread all at once, you can dip it in there. But you know, your body needs that. The tannin was essential for many things. It rid the body of oxides because it's an antioxidant. You could tan hides with it. Now the women wore these nice soft deer hide skirts, and the only way that they got them that way was either brain tanning or putting them in a bath with that tannin to get it that softness. The oak, the bark of the tree, a light tea was made and given to a person that had parasites, and it just dried them up and ran them out of the body. Dyeing material for basketry, you buried the basket materials with oak leaves or oak bark, and that tannin dyed them. I had left a container of oak acorns outside, I don't know, a couple of years, I forgot they were there. And amazingly, through the rains, what's in there? And I pour out the water, all the acorns were tanned black. Oh, and they're beautiful. So I'm going to make some necklaces out of them because we wore them as ornamentation in necklaces and many different things, games, things like that. So there are so many things and benefits to the oak. So I want you to be motivated about learning about the relationship that you can build with nature. You know, trust in it. It knows what it's doing. It's been around for a very long time, and there's a thing or two that can be learned. And and so, you know, as we come to this place that we're in right now, you know, nature became so much for so many people. Probably some people during this time of COVID probably never even explored our back countries here. But, you know, it became a place of sanctuary for people. There was no need for masks out there, no need for distancing. It was a place where we could touch and hold and hug a tree, a plant, something, a rock without fear. So, you know, you can sit under, you know, those mighty trees out there and just, you know, gather, you know, just sit, lay, do nothing. You know, you can take in all those, lay in a field or a meadow with the silence around you, breathing in the fresh air. You know, it holds so much for everybody. When we remove those plants and trees from the land, it causes erosion. And we saw a lot of that devastation after the fires with the floods. So when people go out, and that's another reason why I didn't want to encourage too many people to go out and forage, because they yank them out by the roots. And so you throw up the dirt, you can cause water, to change its course and doing things like that. You can, you're destroying someone's home when you're out there doing that kind of behavior. So you can, their habitat, you can kill them while you're out there. There's sometimes a bird's nest out there. It's really, you got to step back and think for a moment if you are. So if you are going to go out there and pick, there are some rules about that. And they're very simple rules. Some of you, and I know it's became a really wonderful book to read, and that's Braiding Sweetgrass by Robin Wall Kimmerer. And everybody has the same philosophy. Don't pick the first. Don't pick the last. Pick only what you need and can use. Don't waste anything. And when you're doing that, before you even do that, look around. Take inventory of what's in that area. Make an offering of some kind. I always carry in my vehicle like regular tobacco, because I have tobacco seeds, but I haven't grown it yet. But just a supply of things. Sometimes even your hair can be given for the birds for their nest. But I always carry a pouch of offerings that I can give out there. I don't like using flower seeds because you're interrupting the natural landscape by throwing seeds out there, or anything that can seed. So anything that's roasted, like roasted like pumpkin seeds or sunflower, things like that, anything that can just give you a sense that you've paid attention, that you are coming and acknowledging another living being that has a spirit. So it's really important to help and build that. Yeah. So the relationship with the natural world and, let me stop right there. If there's anybody else who has any questions. Is there anybody?
We had a couple questions come through.
Okay.
Let's see. Someone wants to know, what did the oaks tell you for this year in regards to rain?
Not good. Not good. There's a lot. They're very small. They're abundant, but they're very tiny. And they came down, some are still in the trees. So mm-hmm. They're coming down really super late. So we may or may not even get our average. Our average here is 17 inches a year. If we get that, we'll be fortunate. I'll tell you the difference. When I first noticed the abundance of rain and that correlation in 2005, when we had those big floods that washed people out to the ocean, and La Conchita fell, the acorns, like where I'm talking about a difference between an acorn this year, last fall, this big, to 2004, when I was gathering. When I was gathering acorns, I told my cousin Kim, I said, it's going to rain. It just hit me. The acorns were this big. They're almost 4 inches, and they were big round, almost 3.5 inches in diameter. They were gigantic, and they were all over the valley. And it was like towards the end of August, which is really super early. So that's kind of the distinction. I actually had a man tell me, he's with Fish and Wildlife. He goes, I tell people that story, and you have been right every year for 8 consecutive years. So I go, oh, good. I don't write it. I wish I would write it down and keep track, but I don't. I keep it in my head. So I tell other people so that those who are real techie and scientific can start keeping a log and a diary of that. So, okay. Oh, I was going to talk about beavers, Mary. I see that question there. We need our beavers. We need all of our animals back. I mean, why shouldn't we? They were all essential here. That's another thing Robin says in her book. God put the trees and the animals in parts of the world exactly where they need to be. And so we forget about that. We forget about the introduction of non-native any species, animal or plant. So yeah, I'd love to see beavers around here. It'd be great. And unfortunately, we won't have grizzly bears because they're extinct. So yeah. What other questions were there? You said there was a couple.
One more. How would you like Chumash stories to be told in public spaces? Obviously, person-to-person storytelling is best, But what about interpretive signs, artwork, cultural centers that attempt to recount Chumash history and perspectives? Are they helpful?
Only if we have a say in them. Mm-hmm. You know, some people think they're doing well, and they use the words had, did, or was, or maybe the word Ochai meant moon. No, it did. So, you know, and that's from not consulting with Native people. So mm-hmm. I don't mind it. I mean, the more information that people, not everybody goes to museums, not everybody, you know, they didn't learn it in, we didn't learn the right history in school. You don't really start learning about us till higher education. And when I go into that place, they said, why don't we learn this in school? I said, good question. So, you know, again, to have images, it all needs to be consulted, because there are some things, storytellers, you know, my great grandfather, Juan de Jesus Tumamait, was a storyteller. He would take days to tell a story. I think stories are very important. All indigenous cultures around the world, their stories were teachings, they were lessons, they were told as entertainment, but yet also how to learn things at the time when the animals were people, and to heed warnings, and how things were created. So they're important to continue sharing. But yeah, when there's seen, now our relatives up north out at Cal Poly, they have beautiful buildings on campus at Cal Poly that have the northern language of the Chumash language written on their buildings. And so it's beautiful when you see it in that phonetic language. So I think it's important. I think now with the different things that are happening, and in that acknowledgement that people want to put towards the land, that we are on ceded land. I said, you know, we know that. We know our land was stolen. You don't need to tell us that. But what are the other deliverables? What can other people do to help recognize? I think stewardship and helping people and recognizing you as individuals can help by getting and starting that relationship with nature, and learn to appreciate the abundance that we have here. If we ever did have to depend on nature, we'd denude this area immediately. That's why it's important to start creating these gardens, start putting them in your land and your properties, so that you can recognize and start putting the types of food and medicines and all that in your own curation and share with other peoples. You know, when people gathered food, the leader of the villages made sure everybody got some. Nobody was left out. So, you know, the deliverables on acknowledgement of us can come in many forms, depending on who it is and what they're wanting. And but it needs to be with consultation, so that the interpretation is right, you know, instead of kind of coming back and forth, nope, you didn't get it right that time. Let's try again. So I wanted to say the relationship with the natural world and man was universal at one time. It lasted for thousands of years. We all counted on the spirit of the world, the stars in the sky, the phases of the moon. We prayed to gods and the deities for our survival. We also prayed to the flowers, roots and trees and animals, using them to accelerate our prayers into the cardinal directions and upward and onward up into the heavens. We acknowledged the seasons of the year, equinoxes and solstices. And then I wanted to add in here just a little bit about a plant. Now there's little kind of corrections. They're not wrong. It's just that it's people have been kind of the use of sage. Sage is a medicine plant. It was used as a tea, as an astringent for the body. It was used in our acorn granary baskets as an insecticide. It was used at the winter solstice, not burned, but in bundles along the ground, along with artemisia, centering around a feathered pole that went up into the sky, representing the families and leaders. The act of drying and burning sage came in two parts. In the 70s, when people came in from Lakota nations and other nations doing sweat lodge, they ran out of their medicine plants. We knew that we did bundle and burn a particular plant. That was artemisia, which is that really really beautiful minty smelling, they call it coastal sage. It's not a sage at all. But when we had services, funeral services, or if a person died in a home, we would dry and bundle that artemisia and burn it in the homes. We would put it in our ceremonial pipes and blow the smoke onto the widow or widower just to help them with their grieving. It was used for many things. And in modern days, the cowboys, they used to call it cowboy cologne and wear it all over their body. But the sage kind of took off because it was easy and it was easy to bundle and dry. It stayed where the artemisia has little tiny leaves and it didn't hold together very well. But we actually, for smudging people, the way people do with the sage, and they burn it and the smoke goes in with the fan, we used water. We used the fresh sprigs of the artemisia and receive the waters either through the rain or the cold or hot springs. And we would douse people with the water, or people would get in a bowl of water, wooden bowl, and wash their faces in it in the time of Hutash in the fall festivals. So that was our way of smudging, was with the water and the artemisia. So I just wanted to, you know, just kind of put that in there. So here's another plant that is around the world, and that is mugwort. A lot of people use and love mugwort. So in Indo-European people celebrated midsummer solstice. The women would take the mugwort. They would make a braid out of the leaves and stems of the mugwort and make a belt in which they tied around their waist. And then at the ceremonial fires, they would leap over the fire back and forth. They would untie the belt and toss the braided belt into the fire. And that was a purging to get rid of the past, to move forward. So many people have, you know, those type of same ritual uses for the mugwort. It's an amazing plant. It helped our punk for our fire drills to get that first little cinders going so you can start your fire. People had lesions on their skin. You made a little cone after you took the leaves and did this to it. You'd have this like a web, and you make a little cone and you'd place it on a lesion or skin abrasion, set it on fire, and it would draw out. It was good for poison oak, also measles, as a body wash to stop the itching. And so it had many more uses too. People use it today as a relaxant, as like dream pillows and things like that. So there's many uses. It's a beautiful plant. So we should have those again. Let's see. Oh, and it was also used in those particular, I think even in Native cultures, Northern California, I don't know about ours, in boys and girls puberty rites. So I'll go from there to the elderberry. And right now there's two plants and medicines that people that are either have COVID or don't want to get it, and it doesn't take it away, but it helps your body. And that's elderberry and yerba santa. They both, the yerba santa helps keep the bronchial tubes open and free. It's good for the respiration, a respiratory system, and also helps with the blood and all your rest of your body. The elderberry is an immune building plant, the blossoms. So this is the blue elderberry, the Sambucus Mexicana. And no home should really be without it. It's a beautiful tree. It grows big and tall and blooms these beautiful, tiny little yellowish white flowers, and they grow in a cluster and they're just gorgeous. And those are the blossoms you make the tea from. After that, the berries are a dark purple little berry. You have to wait for them. And it's kind of hard to wait because especially in those days, we didn't have many sweet things, but you got to fight everybody else off, the birds and foxes and everybody. Everybody loves elderberry. And I pulled out my clapper stick. This is another thing that's really pretty, you know, not well known, that Chumash didn't have drums. They had this elderberry clapper stick that you use as a percussion. So we, you know, little whistles were made out of the elderberry, dance wands, because they hollow out. There's a pith in the side that you can make some feathered dance sticks with. There was just so many things, again, way too many. Let me see. Okay. Yeah. So just a little mention about that. So like everything else, you know, the mugwort was also noted in Westphalia. I don't even know where that's at. I only know as I'm just writing it down because I looked it up very quickly in some of my books. But I like this one. The women would hold a ceremony and they would dance outdoors at Candlemas, you know, which is once dedicated to the goddess of spring, Bridget. And we just had that on February 2nd. So they would make these whips with the elderberry, not the mugwort, but with the elderberry. And as they're dancing, they playfully, as men approached, tried to whip them to keep them away from the dance. So, I mean, it's just, it's those kind of anecdotes that just give, you know, a person, you know, a sense of creativity, of fun, that, you know, to take it seriously, but yet, you know, nature holds for us so many things. And I don't know if anybody knows where Westphalia is, let us know, because I don't. You know, so once you've educated yourself, this comes from the book, The Untold History of Healing by Wolf Stoll, S-T-O-R-L. I love this guy. He's Austrian, and he's written a couple books. This book, he goes through all indigenous cultures around the world, and he really, you know, gives an outline of how, like, when you have bladder problems, bladder pod, it looks just like a bladder. So he combines how indigenous names for plants became Christian, like Sweet Anne's lace or Saint Catherine's, you know, they became Christianized. So he gets into all that kind of trivia about plants, and I love that kind of stuff. Oh, there, Germany. Okay, thank you. That's where that's at. So once you, I'm going to end. I think, is this it? Yeah. Okay. There's a great many people who have invested and know what a special place this is. We like to see the natural world as a living relative. We don't like using the words natural resources. It allows people to feel free to buy, sell, or put a price on nature. As I do ceremony in my homeland, I tell people we honor the earth every day, but we are relearning how to do that. For the thousands of years that we've had this relationship, it was severed with the arrival of the Spaniards. Nearly 200 years of that. Our families were pulled away from their homes, their way of life. They were set to the task of building the missions and learning to grow row crops and tending domesticated animals. This was sad. No longer being of use, no longer being prayed to or sung to, this natural world was lost. Where'd you go? So, you know, now we have re-entered into this relationship. And it is through this action that we are giving and receiving continuity, familiarity, reciprocity, and continual learning. Keep in mind, Native communities stayed in their regions forever. They never moved. So this establishes settlements and intergenerational relationships that was handed down. Your ancestors came to a new world, bringing with them those things that they felt they can't live without, or that they would miss and need. This included plants, trees, and animals, and a new way to look at this land. They came with no regards to who and what was here. I'm going to end with a quote by Kat Anderson, Tending the Wild. Aboriginal California is gone. We cannot bring it back. All these legacies have relevance today, despite and even because of the changes that have occurred since pre-Columbian times. The extent to which we listen to what they teach us may very well determine the chances for a long-term survival of our species on this planet. And with that, I thank you so very much. I am grateful to be here. I am grateful to be able to learn these things. I'm not an expert by any means in any of it. We're all still learning, and people often ask me, how does it feel to be in your homeland? And it came out as just immediate response, go home. I can't explain it. You have to go to your homeland, wherever that is, and wherever you find yourself resonating with. You come from a very, very unique, just as diverse and special place in your ancestry. We all are. I'm not pure Chumash. I come from your parts of the world. Celtic is right now in my blood. I love Celtic. It just resonates with me. And I want to go there one of these days and go visit those lands. I know my heart and my soul right now will love it. But you choose, you look at what your culture is. You experiment with the sounds and the looks and you know, the landscapes. And once you find that place that really hits you in your heart, you go there and you walk the land, you go to the cemeteries, you go, you know, visit, and you know, if you know your ancestry and which villages and family names, and you look them up, then that's the only time you'll ever know what it feels like to be in your homeland. And like I said, knowing that I'm playing in the same rivers that my great grandmother and my great, 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 when we did the Woolsey fire, we're in sacred places, and they look at me and they go, is this a sacred place? I said, are you kidding me? I said, yes, it is. But one thing I want to tell you, this is not a place where my great, 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 great grandparents were. This is a place where my great grandparents were. We're that closely related to this land. So, you know, it hurts sometimes to see the overdevelopment and the ill responsibility of taking away our natural world. But with all your help and with all your interest, again, I thank you. Blessings to you all. Be well, be safe, and come back and see me in April when we'll talk about gardening. Okay. Any other questions?
Julie, first of all, thank you so much for sharing that. That was great. Mm-hmm. I'm kind of scanning through the chat here to see if we have any other questions. Someone asked about, lots of thanks. Someone asked about Matilaha, and I wanted to.
Oh, the dam. The dam. Yeah, I saw that. It's coming down, but not for another few years.
Do you feel that it'll impact the natural watershed for the better?
Yeah. It all has to go to the ocean. All that sediment, everything that's in there. People shouldn't be living in the watershed. And that's where some of the fight's coming, because people have established homes in the watershed. You know, it's ridiculous. Somebody tried to say years ago that the Ventura River was dead. And then that next year, Mother Earth said, oh yeah, watch this. And Emma Woods was washing motorhomes into the ocean. And then we almost lost that old bridge that was out there. It's not dead. Water is alive. Salip so'o, water is alive. And we must continue to remember that. And it needs to come down. I haven't seen it overflow in ages. We would go up there all the time when it was overflowing, but then it had a crack and they had to decommission it. So yeah, it needs to get out of there. And we'll see a great restoration after that.
Thank you. I also wanted to say for the remaining participants in the Zoom, Julie will be back with us on April 17th for part of our gardening series. She'll be talking about natives and natives.
and since we didn't garden, it's going to be kind of a weird kind of talk. I'm not sure how I'll format it yet, but you know, we'll do it.
Yeah. So make sure you stay tuned. However you heard about this, this webinar or this presentation, will also share about the gardening series coming up soon. Any more questions?
You can always contact me on Facebook too.
I just really appreciate your perspective and your insight. And I think one lesson we can all learn is just nurturing our land and the natural processes. We get what we give back like tenfold with the amount of benefits that our natural world provides us.
I forgot to put a quote, and I love Joseph Campbell, for those of you who know him. He made a brilliant statement about your enemies, about you call them brother or sister, and how can you kill your brother or sister? When it comes to plants, instead of calling it or them, use the words they and thou. And you really start to feel a change immediately in your perspective, and that they are like yerba santa, holy herb. They are sacred. So when we redirect those thoughts, it really changes us inside. So thank you again.
Thank you so much. I don't see any more questions coming in, but lots of thank yous from the group. And this was a really great turnout. Thank you everyone for showing up. So sorry about the technical difficulties. Really appreciate you still joining.
All right. Okay. Well, thank you, everybody.